Hi folks, it's good to have you here for this Bible study. This is not going to be a typical devotion. The subject matter is a little bit heavier than most devotions which you've been seeing here on our Facebook site, because I'll be talking about some of the civil unrest, can I call it, that's been going on in our great city and cities across America. I'm not going to have all the answers. I'm not qualified to give them. I haven't been trained in social interaction between different cultures. I haven't been trained in psychiatry. I don't know anything about those things. I have been trained in the study of this book and how to teach it. And I'm going to take a similar situation that happened 2,000 years ago in the city of Ephesus. And we're going to expound on the facts of this riot in Ephesus. And we're going to find some help, I hope, for us today, that we can have some understanding maybe of what's going on around us. So it's in Acts chapter 19, if you turn there. And to give you a little bit of a background while you're turning to Acts chapter 19, Paul the Apostle went into the city of Ephesus. He's preaching all throughout Asia on his missionary journey. And God's doing great things. And he goes to Ephesus, which is a great city in its day, the third largest city in the Roman Empire. It was home to one of the seven wonders of the world, the Temple of Diana, also called the Temple of Artemis. And you'll find out that this goddess Diana has a lot to do with this riot that we're going to read about. But Paul goes in there and he preaches in the synagogues for 3 months. And he preaches Jesus. He preaches Christ. He preaches the gospel. And he did it in the same place that Jesus did. He did it in the synagogues. He went to God's chosen people. Well, after 3 months of hearing from him once a week, I assume once a week, they were getting pretty tired of it. The religious crowd had had enough, but God was working and they were making converts. And so they kind of made it hard for him to teach in the synagogues anymore. And so he went to a school by the name of a fella, Tyrannus, and he taught every day there, and he did it for 2 years. And so a lot of people heard the gospel, and the Bible says in Acts chapter 19 and in verse number 10 that God blessed him so much that all they which dwelt in Asia, all of them, heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks. Boy, isn't that something? Now read on. God's given him special miracles. Verse 11 and verse 12 said that God's bringing special miracles by the hands of Paul. Here's the account where they took the handkerchief and they passed it around from Paul, and it would heal sick people and drive evil spirits out of those who were possessed. And so special miracles that God was doing. And all of this led to this account now where vagabond Jews, if you read in verse 13, exorcists, they thought they'd get on the action. They didn't want Paul to have all the acclaim. So the religious crowd tries to emulate what God does. They've been imitating what God does, imitating God's miracles all the way back to the book of Exodus. And so they try. It doesn't go very well. And so they go on. And verse 18 says, many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds. And the Bible says they burnt their books and got rid of all their junk that was making them worship false idols. And I mean, today that would be like burning your cigarettes and your alcohol and getting rid of everything that comes between you and God. And they did all of this. So verse 20, mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. Now you get the setting. It took me a few minutes to say all that, but you've got to understand that God is blessing. In other words, what I'm trying to get you to understand is the church for the last 2 years and 3 months had basically declared war on Satan. And the people that follow Satan finally had had enough, and they fight back. And that's where we pick up this story of the riot in Ephesus in Acts chapter 19 and verse 23 now. Acts 19, 23. And the same time there arose no small stir about that way. That way is the church, Christianity. For a certain man named Demetrius, a silversmith, here was his occupation. He made silver shrines for Diana, which brought no small gain unto the craftsmen. In other words, this is how they made their living, and they made a good living making idols. whom he called together, Demetrius did, with the workmen of like occupation. So he got people that are also making money off of making idols. And he said, sirs, you know that by this craft we have our wealth. He's not shy about it. We're making money off of people's religion. And there's always religious people to make money off of. And if you can find a group of people that have convinced themselves that they can make an image and worship it and talk themselves into it generation after generation, there's going to be some smart guys like Demetrius that are going to try to cash in. Let's read on. Verse 26, moreover, you see and hear that not alone at Ephesus, but almost throughout all Asia, this Paul hath persuaded and turned away much people. Well, that's true. The Bible said that was true. It said everybody in Asia heard of Jesus Christ. Isn't that something? Saying there be no gods. This is Demetrius now talking again, which are made with hands. Now, let me stop there. Isn't it silly to think you can make a god with your hand? Isn't it silly to think that you can craft something and worship it? But they did it in the book of Exodus with the golden calf. They're doing it in Ephesus. And we're still doing it today, folks. We're still making idols. And we're still worshiping them because they're replacing God. And that's what's going to drive this. Now look. So this not only our craft is in danger, Demetrius talking again. He's talking to all the other guys that are making money off of religion and people's foolishness. But also that the temple, he's going to get them fired up now, that the temple of the great goddess Diana should be despised. He doesn't care about Diana, he just wants to make money. But he's a good talker. That her magnificence should be destroyed, whom all Asia and the world worshipeth. And when they heard these things, who? The common people, the people that are making money off of religion, people that are making money off of foolish people, worshiping idols. They were full of wrath and cried out, great is Diana of the Ephesians. Verse 29, here's where the riot comes in. Here's where we need to start making some spiritual applications to what we're seeing on the news every day and what's happening in your city. And the whole city, excuse me, verse 28, and when they heard these sayings, they were full of wrath and cried out, great is Diana of the Ephesians. So they have this cause that's been put in front of them. And the cause, though it's not a good cause to them, it makes perfectly good sense. So this is going to be the cause for the idol or for the riot. And the whole city was filled with confusion. Verse 29, can't have a good riot without confusion. And having caught Gaius and Aristarchus, men of Macedonia, who are these guys? Paul's companions in travel. They rushed with one accord into the theater. You should be seeing a picture right now of the theater that they brought them to, 25,000 seat auditorium. And they're going to take these two guys there and probably make them fight animals and watch them get tore to bits. Paul talked about having to do that in Ephesus himself. Here's another similarity with what we're seeing. Innocent people get caught up in it. Gaius and Aristarchus, they haven't done anything wrong. But this crowd is so full of ignorance and so full of religious hatred. And hatred can come in many forms. In this case, it's religious hatred. And really, the cause of the whole thing is money. They grab these two guys, so you have... Again, you've got confusion in every riot, and you've also got innocent people getting hurt in every riot. Let's keep reading. And Paul, in verse 30, he wants to go to the theater to try to help out. And verse 31, they say, no, you're not going to go to the theater, Paul. Verse 32, look at this, another element of every riot. Some, therefore, cried one thing, and some another, for the assembly was confused. And look at this. And the more part knew not wherefore they were come together. They see all the people running to the theater, and there's this riot going on in the city, and people are hollering, great is Diana of the Ephesians, and they're rummaging through and tearing things up. Every riot is the same. And this is saying the same thing that's going on right now. The majority of people don't even know why they're there. They don't know. That's a riot. Verse 33, look at this now. And they drew Alexander out of the multitude, the Jews putting him forward. And Alexander beckoned with the hand. Who's Alexander? Well, he's kind of a leader of the Jews. Now, wait a minute. I thought the Jews were against idols. They are. They're against idols. They are against the idolatry that's going on in their city. Now, there was a time when the Jews were worshiping idols, and back in the time of the kings, but they hadn't worshiped idols at this point for a long time, hundreds of years. So they're against this temple of Diana being in their city. But yet, they try to join sides and they try to talk with the people in this riot. Why? Because the enemy of my enemy is my friend. They, as much as they don't want Diana worship and idol worship going on in their city, in the great temple of Diana, one of the seven wonders of the ancient world, they even worse than that don't want this upstart Christianity that claims to be coming out of Judaism, that claims to have the Messiah, and that is basically by their preaching saying anyone who hasn't accepted Jesus and who is still a Jew under the old way in the Old Testament is wrong. They don't want to hear any of that. And they're going to take old Alexander and shut this thing down. It's funny who you'll make bedfellows with when there's confusion. See, every good riot has this element. Somebody smart will try to take advantage of it. Take the thing that's naturally happened and try to turn it to their advantage. We see that today, don't we? Let's read on. Are you getting why this is so good and so applicable to us today? Alexander beckoned with the hand and would have made his defense to the people, but look at this. But when they, who? The people, the rioters, when they knew he was a Jew, they said, oh, that's that Jewish guy. That's that Jewish leader. What's he doing up there? Here's what they did. They automatically made this thing about religion. Now, all of a sudden, it's not about most of them don't even know why they're there. The Bible said that. All of a sudden, now they're unified. This guy's a Jew up there talking, and they say, look at that, verse 34. And they all cried with one voice about the space of 2 hours. Great is Diana of the Ephesians. Great is Diana of the Ephesians. You can't have a good riot without a chant. Every riot's got a chant, and this riot's chant is great is Diana of the Ephesians. What brought it on? Well, all it took was a religious leader getting up there, and that was enough. They said, oh, it's about religion. Well, we're here, and we're going to say great is Diana of the Ephesians. Verse 35, some guy with some power, they call him the town clerk, he comes in and appeases the people, and that's what will happen with all of this eventually. He comes in and he schmoozes them, he talks nice to them, he says, listen, folks, everybody knows that Diana is the great god. Everybody knows she came down from Jupiter. Why are you sitting here arguing? Why are you worrying about it? The whole world is behind you. Don't worry. This is all fine. And then he says, listen, verse 37, you brought these two guys in and want me to tear them to bits. I'm not going to do that. And here's why. Verse 38 says, listen, guys, the law is open and there are deputies. Let them plead with one another. He says, Demetrius, if you got a problem with what this church is doing and what they're doing to your business, take it to the law, which is exactly what reasonable, rational people are saying today, isn't it? Let's just take it to the law. There's lawful ways to get what you want. And look what he says. This is very important. And I wish that the people that are causing all of this confusion and causing all of this damage and hurting innocent people and damaging property and not even knowing why they're really doing it, I wish they'd read verse 40. Some reasonable people have gotten on the news recently and said this very thing, for we are in danger to be called in question for this day's uproar, the riot. There being no cause whereby we may give account of this concourse. He said, listen, guys, if you tear the city to bits, you've got a just cause. You've got a case. You've got something that needs to be heard. But you're doing it the wrong way. That's what the town's clerk said. And that appeased the people. And they settled down. They went their way. And that's what eventually will happen here. Eventually, this riot, like all riots, will run its course. The people won't be heard, even though they had a grievance, because a few people got involved and started doing things the wrong way, started hurting innocent people, and that's where you lose compassion and support from people that can help you. I've heard church members say this, well, all them people need, all them rioters and all them people, if they just had Jesus, they wouldn't be doing this. I guess they didn't read about the riot in Ephesus because Jesus is the cause of the riot. Or at least the church preaching Jesus is the cause of the riot. And I would say to you that a riot under those conditions would just about be welcome today. That would mean that the church is alive. That would mean the church is awake. That would mean the church is shaking this earth. That the whole earth would know. All of Asia knew about Jesus Christ. Are we doing as good of a job as them? Enough to cause a riot? Nah, I fear not. And so, I'll leave you with this. Let's keep fighting the devil. Let's fight him harder than what we have been. Let's take a lesson from the riot at Ephesus. Let's realize the devil will fight back if the church will just give him a reason to. I'll leave you with that. God bless you. Thank you for watching this Bible study. I hope it's been a help to you.